Do you own or rent your home? Sure you do, and I bet it can be hard work. You know what's easy? Bundling policies with Geico. Geico makes it easy to bundle your homeowners or renters insurance along with your auto policy.
And it's a good thing, too, because you already have so much to do around your home. Go to geico.com, get a quote, and see how much you could save. It's Geico easy. Visit geico.com today. That's geico.com.
Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
Wow. They did not stop talking.
It's exhausting.
It's the Bob and Sheri Show with Bob.
Why don't you give the storytelling a rest and try something else?
And Sheri.
She looks like a wooden doll you'd find in an Eastern European toy shop.
And now broadcasting from the palatial Bob and Sheri Studios, it's Bob and Sheri.
I am watching the best UFO show on Netflix that I want to tell you about that I think that you would really even like, Bob. But first, I just want to remind you that Worthy is the best way to sell the diamond jewelry or other jewelry that you're never going to wear again. Maybe it's a relic of a former relationship, and it's time to move on and turn that dusty old ring into cash. Worthy.com/Sheri. You can schedule a free secure pickup, fully insured at no cost to you by Lloyd's of London. They will expertly appraise it. It'll sell at an auction to their exclusive buyers at a price you set. And the minute it sells, you get paid instantly. Worthy.com/Sheri. That's Worthy. Sheri. So the show that I'm watching on Netflix is called Top Secret UFO Projects Declassified. And it's on Netflix, and it's super, super good because it covers a wide range of sightings and all the different military operations, some of which we knew about and some that we didn't, like Project Blue Book and Operation Sign. And they interview people that were connected to the military and the Pentagon. They talk about the Tic Tac videos that the Navy released. It's really well done, and it doesn't have, you know how, like, I love Ancient Aliens, but, you know, Ancient Aliens can get a little bit much, you know, when you've got the, could our ancient alien ancestors be the reason some of us don't like mayonnaise? You know, you get a lot of that on Ancient Aliens.
Uh-huh. Right.
But Top Secret UFO Projects Declassified, especially if you're like a kind of a wingnut like I am, is really, really interesting because there's a ton of old archival footage in there that I'd never seen before. Like, you think you've seen everything, you think you've heard every story, but here's something, like, just as an example from one of the, I think it's either the first or second episode. So the night of the alleged flying saucer crash in Roswell, New Mexico, one of the people, one of the military guys who responded on the scene and was an eyewitness is named Jesse Marcel. And his son, who is now, I don't even, 60s maybe, his son, who's a grown man himself now, says that the night that happened, his father came into his bedroom and woke him up. He was like maybe 9 or 10 years old, woke him up and said, son, this is the only time I'm ever going to be able to show you something that came from a real UFO. And he had brought a box home from the crash site, and in it were some very odd sort of flexible metals that were kind of like aluminum, but not. And some object, he had no idea what it was, that was glowing and illuminated. And according to Jesse Marcel's son, he and his dad were looking at these artifacts and handling them. And his dad was telling him what had just happened, that this flying saucer had crashed, when the phone rang. And it was his commanding officer telling him, get back here right now, get back on base. Because initially, the military released reports to the press that a flying saucer had crashed. And only after it got out did they backtrack and say, oopsies, never mind, it was a weather balloon. So it's that kind of stuff. And it's really, really well done and super interesting and suspenseful and loaded up with all sorts of images and stories you may not have seen. It's called,
what's the name of it again?
Top Secret UFO Projects Declassified on Netflix. so good. This is what I was doing over the last couple of days when one kid's at school, the other kid's out of town, my husband's taking care of preemies. I'm home eating vegetables and watching UFO documentaries, and truly, that is my best life.
You know what I watched the other day? How to Be a Tyrant.
Oh, what did you learn?
Well, they take several horrible people. They take Mao and Stalin. Of course, Hitler is on the list. Mussolini. And they say they all have certain things in common. They wanted to be tyrants. They wanted to control, be dictators. And I can't remember all of the things, but here are a couple of them. Find some followers who are really, really unhappy with their lives. That's the first thing that you need to do. Then find some other people who you can say, these are the people that make your lives miserable. So you got to find some villains. That way the followers really get all juiced up and they're going to start following you. Then get some really cool uniforms. Get some really cool, intimidating uniforms. And you can say what you want about the Nazis. They had some cool uniforms. And there were a variety of find a guy who will be able to look at the press and do bald-faced lies. Just look right at them and just put out stuff that you know is not true. But this guy, Goering was for Hitler, can just look into a camera and tell a bald-faced lie, and then find somebody else who can manipulate the media to make you look good and your enemies look bad. And they just went down one after another, and whether it was in China or Germany, wherever it was, they all had the same plan, and very often it works, and it still goes on today. That is the scary thing.
In all seriousness, did you spot any parallels to some bad corporate leadership we've had in the past? I'm not kidding.
Oh, yeah.
No,
that's right. It's just on a lower level, of course.
Yeah, smaller scale, yeah. Ooh,
right.
So that's How to Be a Tyrant. What channel is that? Because Top Secret UFO is Netflix.
I think this
I think it's Netflix.
Netflix.
How to Be a Tyrant is
Netflix,
too?
Yeah.
Yes, I've been thinking about doing it as like a hobby, you know.
Yeah, right. In your spare time.
It's Bob and Sheri.
Congratulations, Sheri Lynch, named one of the most influential women in radio again this year. It's Bob and Sheri.
So we were just talking about a TV show that I saw on Netflix. It's just been added, I think, recently, How to Be a Tyrant. And it's a little bit tongue-in-cheek. They use some cartoon drawings, animation. They use some real clips out of the past. And it just shows you, if you want to be a dictator, an evil dictator, this is what you need to do. Find some people who are very dissatisfied with their lot in life, and then find another group of people and blame all of the problems of your country on those people. Obviously, that's what Hitler did with the Jews in Germany in the 1930s. And exploit that. Get a group of people who are going to be your intimidation squad. These are people that if you see them show up in brown shirts with black ties and black pants, you know that they mean business. So you're starting to get intimidation. Promise everybody that you are going to be the savior, but at the same time, say that you are a victim. Because the people that feel that they're not getting their lot in life, when they hear that you're saying that you're a victim, they identify with that.
That's so interesting. So my question to you was, have you, now that you've watched How to Be a Tyrant, are you looking at that and going, oh, I've seen the small scale version of this at work a time or two?
Well, until you brought it up, I hadn't reflected on that. I was just so amazed at the old footage they had of Mussolini and Stalin and all of these people. You also have to be able to kill without giving a second thought. The idea of losing the people of your own country means nothing to you. So from a corporate standpoint, yeah, with a lighter version, I think I have seen that. Let's take the who to blame. And I can only reflect on my own business. If you're running with the last couple of companies that we worked for, not the one now, they're great, but the last couple of ones, they always had somebody to blame for their problems. Usually it was Bob and Sheri.
But
anything
they were
went
never,
wrong. Oh, Bob and Sheri. Yeah, Bob and Sheri talk too much.
They never had any sort of proactive anything. It was all about just moving the target and blaming. And we've actually worked for a couple of people that were openly frightening to some employees.
Yes. And a lot of those employees have been women.
Oh, almost all of the employees were women, not just a lot of them.
I was really surprised about that in this day and age that we were working for a company that punched down on women.
A couple of them, actually. Yeah. It's a weird, it shocked me too. And I think it shocked some of the women that were on the receiving end of it, because they were also saying what you're saying, which is, hello? Right now, you're doing this now? This can't really be happening. I must be imagining this, because there's no way you're doing this right now in front of God and everybody. And yet they were.
Especially because the best salespeople were women.
Yeah.
That's who is bringing in your money. I mean, it was the damnedest thing. Thank God that's over.
But I've seen, like, even in families, I've seen some of what you describe play out in families. You need a victim. You need a scapegoat, right? You wield power by first making people think that everyone else is out to get them, and then that they can't live without you. I mean, you see this kind of thing play out.
Oh, the other thing is you're the only one. You're the only one who can fix whatever the problem is.
What's amazing to me, I'm going to watch this now. What's amazing to me about this is this pattern repeats over and over and over again, and we don't ever seem to catch it and learn.
I know.
The show is called How to Be a Tyrant on Netflix. Morons in the News is next. It's Bob and Sheri.
Bob and Sheri.
You idiot.
Here they are.
He's a moron. He's acting like a complete idiot.
Morons in the News.
Alan Slattery is 67 years old. He's retired. He lives near London, England. And a few days ago, he went into a building called the Nationwide Building Society Branch, which is basically a bank. And he handed over a note. The note was so poorly written that the bank employee was unable to read the note and said, "I don't understand, sir, what you want." He became very angry and then just threw his hands up in the air, turned around, and left. They eventually were able to study the note, and it said, "Your screen won't stop what I've got. Just hand over the 10s and 20s. Think about the other customers." They then rang the police, who attended, seized the note, took a look at the footage from the security camera, and went and arrested Mr. Slattery. He also had recently evidently robbed a couple of other banks, where he got about $3,000 before they called the police. But basically, he just wrote it. I'm looking at it, and it says, "Your," I can't make out the next word, "won't stop." I can't make out that or that. "Just hand," I can't see that. "Tens and 20s. It is the worst hand. If you are so stupid that you don't pre-read what your stick-up note is going to say, you were the worst bank robber ever. They got him, and he is getting, listen to this, 6 years in jail.
This is why Sister Regina Carmel always said that penmanship mattered, even if it seemed old-fashioned.
That's right.
There are so many teachable moments and life lessons for today's moron of the day. It's an 18-year-old in Orlando, Florida. So it's about 5:45 in the morning when Florida State Troopers, come upon a single vehicle crash. And so they're going to investigate. There's a car crashed on the interstate, and it's off the road. It's on the median, up against the fence. Has someone been injured? The troopers are doing their job. So as the state trooper approaches the vehicle, here comes the driver. And the driver goes after the state trooper with something in his hand, some unidentified object or weapon in his hand.
Not a good idea.
So the state trooper takes him down. The driver runs off into the woods and hides. This leads to an enormous police search that took about 5 hours. He was found by Sheriff's Office canine dogs who bit him when they found him. So he had to be taken to the hospital for his canine dog bite. He's facing charges of battery on a law enforcement officer. He's faced with resisting arrest. He's faced with having a BB gun in his wrecked vehicle. He's faced with injuring the state trooper and with being a complete idiot. So here's what we have to teach our kids.
Unless you're in Montana and you're pretty deep into it, it's pretty hard to hide from the popos in the woods. You know?
I mean, eventually they go and get you. So here's what we need to teach our kids. We need to teach them how to act if they get into an accident on the highway.
That's right.
Today's Moron of the Day up on our Facebook so that you can find it. And before we run out of time, we missed this one the other day. I don't know why, because it's been the summer of snakes and skunks. Did you see the story in Australia? A woman was in the grocery store on the spice aisle browsing the spices when suddenly the head of a 10-foot-long non-venomous diamond python poked through a space in the shelf right above the spice jars.
Holy cow.
10-foot-long. The woman said, "I was in the spice aisle just looking for something to put on the chicken. I didn't initially see it. I kind of turned to my right and it poked its head out. What are the odds?"
God.
What are the odds?
But would you ever be right?
Customer? Well, here's the thing. This customer, a trained snake catcher.
No.
A professional snake catcher.
No.
She said the snake's head was within 8 inches of her face. She said, "I have a background in snakes, so I was pretty calm about it. But, you know, it shocked me because I wasn't expecting it." Well, ma'am, no one is expecting a 10-foot-long python in the spice aisle at the grocery store.
No, that's right.
She used her phone to take some video as the snake extended its entire body from the shelf, slithered into the aisle, and wandered off down. She went to the manager and said, "I'm gonna go get my snake bag." She got the snake catching bag from her house, captured the snake, and released it into the nearby woods.
Golly.
Customer of the day.
Got to be. What's the likelihood of that person at that moment? That's amazing.
Isn't that great? This is Morons in the News. It's Bob and Sheri.
People, pay attention because I do not want to have to fail you.
Bob and Sheri want you to help us salute deserving teachers. 5 winners will receive a box of school supplies, Bob and Sheri swag, a Bob and Sheri branded Visa gift card worth $100, and a 1-year Stamps.com subscription valued at $200.
4.5 gold stars for you.
Get discounted USPS and UPS postage right from your computer at Stamps.com. Use promo code Sheri to start a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale.
May I have your attention? It's the Bob and Sheri Teacher Appreciation Contest.
Enter your deserving teacher at bobandsheri.com.
Sign up for the newsletter with Bob and Sheri exclusive articles. Sign up now at bobandsheri.com.
I have banned the word staycation in my house.
I remember you said that, yeah.
It's banned. I don't want to hear, like my husband, I was having a hysterical weeping meltdown. And I was like, "I just want to go look at the ocean for one day, just one day." And my husband goes, "Sweetie, I have some ideas for a great staycation." And I'm like, "Never say that word again. I hate that word so much."
I don't picture him using that word. That's so unusual. I mean, it's kind of a recent pop expression.
It shocked me. And honestly, when he said it, Karen, his head whipped around like, "Where am I and what's happening?" So I said, "I don't want a staycation. I want to go somewhere." And so I banned the word. And then sure enough, because my phone or my iPad heard me say that word, it served me up something in my newsfeed about the mistakes that people make on staycation. And the biggest one is the reason I don't want to go on a staycation. And that is...
Can I guess what it is?
Guess it.
That instead of really doing pleasurable things, you clean the cat throw up in the garage. You throw away trash that's been building up behind the house. You do all of these annoying things you never have time for during the week.
Exactly. You don't unplug from your life.
Right.
You maybe you're not going to your job, but you're not unplugged from your life. You're not seeing new things, tasting new things. You're scraping dried cat barf off the floor of the garage. So so I'm reading this article about all the ways to not screw up your staycation. And one of the suggestions they made, I could not talk you or my husband into on a dare. And that is, it says, take a guided tour. Don't think of it as the place you live. Think of it as a new place you're exploring. My husband has lived in this city his entire life. You think he's getting on, he's paying for and getting on a guided tour? Do you really
If he is, I feel sorry for the tour guide, because this is what it's going to sound like. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going along right now South Boulevard, and from the back is your husband going, "That's where the Pepsi plant used to be. The Pepsi plant is, you see those condos? That's where the Pepsi plant used to be."
Oh, have you been riding in the back seat? We didn't know you were there. He'll say, "Come on, woman, let's go for a little ride in the truck." And so, and he'll roll the window down and I can hang my head out. It's how I stay sane. And so we'll be driving along.
You're like a basset hound.
Yeah. And he'll go, "You see that over there?" And I'll look over there. And what I see is a shopping center with a TJ Maxx and, you know, like a Kohl's and a grocery store. And he'll say, "When I was a kid, we used to ride our BMX bikes there." "Oh, okay. Drive a little bit further. See that over there? It's an apartment complex. There were cows there. It feels like a week ago." "Oh, okay. Can I put my head back out the window yet? Is it time for that?"
I just read an article about this. It's a guy thing. A guy hits a certain age, especially if it's a situation like your husband living in the same town all his life, or somebody that, you know, in their 20s moved there and now they're, you know, 50 and they can't believe that the Dairy Queen is gone and there's a steakhouse there. But what the article said was, guys, women don't care. They don't care that you know that the Longhorn, which burned down, is now a dry cleaners. They don't care that you used to love to go to the Longhorn and you had your first date at the Longhorn. They don't care.
It's so funny how it's not like a big historical site. Like, that's the birthplace of President so-and-so. It's always right. What you're describing. When I was a kid, there was a Dairy Queen there, and then one time it burned down, and now it's nothing. It's always stuff like that.
But I'm just going to be honest. When I went to see my friends in Connecticut, I hadn't been in 2 or 3 years, I'm driving through one of the towns that we lived in for a while, and I was by myself, and I was saying to myself, "Oh, that's the Luncheonette my mom used to like. It's not a, it's a pizza place now. How about that?" Who would care?
I do that. When I go to visit like my family out west or up north, I'll be like, "What happened to blah blah blah? When did they put a Panera here?" Like, we're all guilty of it.
You know what I found is true, though. Here's what I found is true. My wife doesn't care that place was a Dairy Queen and now it's a pizza place. My wife would like to know if I say, "Oh, that's Mary DeGozio's house. That was like the first girl I ever kissed." "Oh, really?"
"Oh, no, I'm right
oh,
there
really?
With Mary.
Where is she now?" And she's got the phone out and she's finding Mary DeGozio on the phone to show me what she looks like today. And she wants to know, were you ever alone, like in the backseat of a car, you know, over in an apple orchard with Mary DeGozio? She's all about that. And she is so good with the phone that she will find Mary DeGozio, who is now a real estate dealer who doesn't quite look the same as I remember her. She loves.
That is a good time. I once persuaded my husband to take me on a driving tour past all the houses of all of his teenage girlfriends so that I could critique their parents' taste in real estate. Now, that's my idea of a staycation, people. Yeah. That is a stay freaking
cation. Yeah, that's a staycation.
All right, straight ahead, we've got comedian Chad Thornsberry. We're going to take you down the rabbit hole. We're going to take you to Target and why taking a vacation, not a staycation, a vacation can literally save your life. It's all coming up. It's Bob and Sheri.
It's a fact that a child's body temperature rises 3 to 5 times faster than an adult's, and leaving a child in a hot vehicle can lead to their death very quickly.
Sadly, in 2020, 24 children died of pediatric vehicular heat stroke, and many of these incidents occurred when parents or caregivers simply forgot the child was in the car.
Unintentionally leaving a child in a car is a tragedy that can happen to anyone. Please set yourself reminders on your cell phone or place something you'll need in the back seat to help you remember that your child is still in the car.
If your partner or caregiver is taking your child to daycare, check with them or the child care staff to make sure that the child was dropped off. And when you've arrived at your destination, always check to make sure the car is empty.
Heat stroke deaths are preventable when adults take the proper precautions. Be safe and always look for your baby before you lock.
Paid for by NHTSA.
Do you own or rent your home? Sure you do, and I bet it can be hard work. You know what's easy? Bundling policies with GEICO. GEICO makes it easy to bundle your homeowner's or renter's insurance along with your auto policy.
And that's a good thing, too, because you already have so much to do around your home. Just go to GEICO.com, get a quote, and see how much you could save. It's GEICO easy. Visit GEICO.com today. That's GEICO.com.
It's the Bob and Sherry Store's sizzling summer sidewalk sale. Everything in stock is on sale, 10% off.
10% off!
Including Sherry Lynch's cookbook, Cooking with Cats. And swag you can use, like Bob and Sherry 24-ounce latte mugs, travel mugs, H2Go water bottles, and our very hot line of mother of all mothers merch, including tote bags, candles, wear around tee and sleep shirts.
10% off.
It's the sizzling summer sidewalk sale. Everything is 10% off. Just hit shop at bobandsherry.com and use the discount code podcast at checkout. Bob and Sherry, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sherry.
All right, it's time now for Everyone Needs a Laugh. Today, it's comedian Chad Thornsberry.
Now, a lot of comics, they get up here and they bash marriage and they rip their wives. It's a very popular thing to do. It can be very funny. I get that. I really don't do that. I am married myself. I love my wife. She's absolutely incredible. And with all the stuff going on, it's very comforting for me in the world. You know, all these people getting divorced is very comforting for me. I know that we will never get divorced, ever. You want to know how I know that? We don't own anything worth fighting over. What are we going to divorce over? Our thrift store couch? The worst divorce ever. You're going to load that thing up and haul it off when you leave here. No, I loaded that piece of junk up once and brought it here. I'm not loading it back up again. I got a cut on my leg from the spring that shoots through the bottom of it. I'm not touching it. The only time that I was ever worried that something like that might possibly happen to us is anytime she wants to play board games. Now, my wife is very competitive. So am I. That doesn't work out. Let me explain something to you fellas. You beat your wife three times in a row playing Connect Four. You're going to be connecting with the couch later on. Just the way life works out. But she had some people over one night. She said, hey, you know what we should do? Let's play a game. Yeah, that's a good idea. We haven't hated each other yet today. Let's do that. And she goes to the closet and she brings out the game Pictionary. I'm not going to belabor you guys with all the rules to Pictionary, but the last square on the board is called All Play. Whenever anybody's on that square, everybody draws the same word at the same time. Whichever team screams it out first wins. My turn to draw for the win. Look at the word gorilla. I can't draw a gorilla. But what I can do is this. I can draw a tree where she will guess tree. I will draw a banana in the tree. She will guess banana. And then I'm going to draw something in the tree hanging on to the banana. Looks like it's got a head and a tail and a foot. And she's going to go, monkey. And I'm going to give her this sign. And she's going to click down to gorilla. That's the way it's playing in my head. For the win, gorilla, tree, banana, chimpanzee, and I know what's getting ready to happen. I'm starting to sweat. I can feel my pulse pick up a little bit, you know. It's not a chimpanzee? No. It isn't. Chip, that's the same thing. Can't you shorten the word? And then you just lose your mind, start arguing with everybody. Well, Chad, you're not supposed to talk during Pictionary. Does it look like we're helping each other out over here? It took you 45 seconds to get light bulb. How about you worry about your own game? We end up losing. Of course. My fault. Of course. She asked me, what was it? It was a gorilla. Chet, that doesn't look like a gorilla. You're right, it doesn't. It doesn't look like a chimpanzee, and you guess that 14 times.
That's Chad Thornsberry. Check out our website, BOBANDSHERI.com. That's where you'll find all the comics we feature every day on Everyone Needs a Laugh. It's Bob and Sheri.
Leave us a talkback. Talkback with the free Bob and Sheri app.
A therapist I was reading had this question. If you were not related to your relatives, would you be friends with them? If no, then why does it matter so much to you what they think? I think that's a great question.
It is a great question.
Because I think for so many of us, our friends really are more of our family than our family family. Not in every case. I mean, there are people, they're as tight as can be. Maybe they bump heads here and there. But in reality, the friendships that you've garnered over the years have become more like a family in many cases than your actual family. I don't know why I let other people bother me by what they think of me. I had somebody in the past, I think I might have mentioned this to you at one time, and it was when you and I were just starting out. And so we're discussing, this person and I are discussing the fact that I've taken on a new role and I have a new partner. We don't know where it's going. It's unproven, this radio show. And the person said, well, I have my education to fall back on if anything happens with me. Because the person knew that I have 2 years of college. And I thought, that is an odd thing to say. That's a little passive aggressive there.
A little bit.
It was kind of about me and my worries about a new venture in my career. But all of a sudden, it became not only about you and what you could do, but it came also around that I might fail and will have nowhere to go. You know, so why, if that person thinks that of me, why do I care anything about what he or she thinks?
I mean, I don't, you tell me what's the answer for that?
I don't know what the answer is.
I mean, because you don't want to disappoint people, maybe?
Yeah, maybe. And then people are interconnected. You know, you cut one person out, but they've got a cousin that you see or a spouse that you see. And now there's some friction because you're still coming together for gatherings or family reunions or whatever. But bottom line, you shouldn't even think twice about somebody that you know does not really have your best interest at heart.
It's just hard when, I mean, that's easier to do, I think, with strangers and neighbors and casual acquaintances. I think it is really hard. I think it is really hard to do when it's your family, because even if your family's kind of nutty, like my family, you still want their approval. You want to make them proud. You know, you want to, I don't know what it is, whether it's not that you want to outdo them, but maybe you want to outdo their expectations of you.
Yeah, but I think what in the case that I'm talking about, I think it's a little bit different. I agree with what you just said. Even if your family's a little nutty, you want them to know that, well, we're all nutty together. You know, I have your back. I think you would have mine. But I think what I do for a living irritated this person to his or her core. I think there's just something about the idea that I've got this whimsical job where I hang out with friends and, you know, we say funny things or we comment on the passing parade of America and so on. That's an actual job kind of irritated this person because they had a real, you know, put on a tie, go to work sort of gig.
The word you're looking for isn't irritated. The word you're looking for is envious. How dare you, the family dip, get it, such a quote unquote easy, fun job. Now that person has no idea what the job is really like, but they look at you and go, well, you know, why do I have to be an accountant or, you know, whatever, like hard grown up serious job where you have to wear uncomfortable clothes and pay attention. Why do I have to do that? And this guy just gets to goof off for a living. I think that's jealousy. Is that possible?
Let me think about that for a moment. I'm still trying to get by that I'm the family dip.
Well, you may not be, but that was the attitude.
Honestly, partner, you could have gone a lot of different ways that I'm the family.
He's not going to be jealous of the family genius. I mean, he has a low opinion of you, and that's why he couldn't believe you fell into such a
Well, that
a
eliminates
gig.
Me from being the family genius for sure.
Y'all need to be my kin folks. In my family, all you have to do to be a superstar is not go to jail. If you can just stay out of the correction system, girl,
that's
you're
it,
a rock
huh?
star.
Keep the bar low. Yeah, yep. Keep the bar really low. It's Bob and Sheri.
Instant access to the podcast, and fun side. Just download the free Bob and Sheri app. Bob and Sheri, go.
One of my favorite things about this one was in the comments section. This is every mom at Target. And in the comments section, person named Kaylin Harris posted, "You don't go to Target to get what you need. You go to Target and Target tells you what you need." Is that not the truth? Here's the whole family. Every mom at Target.
What are you doing?
I'm going to Target.
You're putting on makeup.
Yeah.
For Target?
Duh. Last time I went looking like a troll, I ran into your ex-girlfriend.
You did? How many pillows do you need to sleep?
Oh, these aren't for sleeping.
What are they for?
These are the barrier pillows.
Huh?
For my barrier.
What barrier?
This one is for your snoring.
I don't snore that bad.
This one is to block the light from your phone.
Uh-huh.
This one is to protect me from your feet and your unclipped toenails.
I try to cut my...
It just creates that protection from your general self.
This is not very romantic.
Love you.
Love you too.
Hey, do you work here?
No.
Oh, I'm so sorry. You're just in a red shirt.
No worries. What are you looking for?
Garden boots?
Good question. They used to be here in the footwear, but in the summer, they move them over to lawn and garden. But since that area is now transitioning to like back to school, they have those usually on a Wednesday. They put them on an end cap until like the total end of the season. Real hit or miss, but I'd head over there right now. TikTok. You should, no, the other way. You're going, no, it's this way. Go this way. Let me show you. I want to be the type of person who wears matching outfits when I work out. I want to be the type of person who does yoga. I want to be the type of person who juices things.
Honey, what is this?
I honestly don't even know. I feel like if we don't buy it right now, I'm going to get home and I'm going to regret not having it. So I think we just get it now just to have
what
it.
What is?
Just to have
what
it.
What is this?
I don't know. It's fine. Just buy it. It's fine.
Anything you need to tell me?
Oh, God, no. But aren't these adorable? I saw that pregnant woman yesterday.
Do you even know her?
No, but aren't these adorable? I need to give these to her.
It's kind of creepy.
These are teeny tiny sandals. I'm going to start sending birthday cards to people, put a stamp on it, walk to the mailbox. I'm going to be that type of person. Don't you think if I get a new journal, my life will dramatically change? Like, this is the key. Just one more new journal. Just one more. I'm going to wear fancy PJs now.
So you're not going to wear that 1997 concert t-shirt that you wear to bed every single night?
You're right. I do have limits. Look at me. Man, I'm really proud of myself right now.
Whoa, that's not on the list.
Oh, the list is more of a suggestion.
Kim, you came here for dish soap and bananas.
Oh, they're in here. Don't you worry.
Okay, any baby wearing that, the weight would cripple them and they would
fall
to the ground.
I know, but they could have like their snacks in there.
What does a baby need to carry?
This part of Kim, just like this part's real, of her looking at the flipping baby stuff. Our youngest is 11.
It's a little t-shirt with little...
You guys have a thing that guys don't have when it comes to this.
Last time I went looking like a troll, I ran into your ex-girlfriend.
Really? How'd she look?
We'll post it on Facebook so you can look.
That stuff about wanting to buy the cute baby stuff, that is so my wife. When we started having grandchildren, she was never happier than to be able to go online and get these. My grandkids have so much stuff from her, and it's all cute and all, but it's like an addiction.
I can't go to Target because I can't be trusted. Cara Mia wanted to go get a couple of things for the whole dorm situation, and she wanted to go to Target. So we went to Target. We were in there for a couple of things. I think we needed two carts. I ended up buying groceries, a floor lamp. I mean, I would have bought a fourth husband if one had been on sale. Like, I just cannot be trusted. We'll post up every mom at Target right now on the Bob and Sheri Facebook. And coming up on the show, if you are dying to take a vacation, go ahead and do it. Because not taking one could literally kill you. All the details straight ahead. It's Bob and Sheri.
People, pay attention because I do not want to have to fail you.
Bob and Sheri want you to help us salute deserving teachers. Five winners will receive a box of school supplies, Bob and Sheri swag, a Bob and Sheri branded Visa gift card worth $100, and a one-year Stamps.com subscription valued at $200.
4.5 gold stars for you.
Get discounted USPS and UPS postage right from your computer at Stamps.com. Use promo code Sheri to start a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale.
May I have your attention? It's the Bob and Sheri Teacher Appreciation Contest.
Enter your deserving teacher at BobandSheri.com.
Swag you can use. Just hit shop at BobandSheri.com.
I have really enjoyed going through this website that I found the other day and reading about soldiers, American soldiers, who love their country so much. They did amazing things on the battlefield. I called this feature, What's a Guy Gotta Do? Because at the end of every one of these articles, it's on Ranker, people will rank, is he a true hero or is he not a true hero? So let me tell you about John Robert Fox. John Robert Fox, in December 1944, was a first lieutenant stationed in a village in Italy, Samocca Colonna, I think is how it's pronounced, along with the 92nd Infantry Division, and they were also known as the Buffalo Soldiers. Now, stay with me here. Fox and a small party of men volunteered to stay behind in that village, which, though it was under Allied control at the time, was facing an advance by the German Nazi troops. Fox's job was to call out defensive artillery strikes from the second story of a house. So what he's supposed to do is go to the top of the house, right, look out and see where the German soldiers are, and then call in strikes from wherever the cannons were for our guys. Well, as more and more German soldiers arrived in the area, Fox was called to call in strikes closer to his own location. Eventually, Fox and his team were simply overmatched, and he said, "Fire it!" Fox called for an artillery strike on his exact position. The operator he spoke to was in disbelief, but Fox said, "There's more of them than there are of us." The strike took out Fox and took out all of his men, but also 100 Nazi soldiers, and created an opportunity for our guys to reclaim the area. In 1997, Mr. Fox was awarded the Medal of Honor along with six other Black Americans who fought in World War II. So at the bottom of this story, it says, true hero? 5,001 people said, yes, he is a true hero. 60 people said, no, a true hero.
Based on what? So,
I asked the question, what's a guy got to do? He called in cannon strikes on himself and his own men, knowing that was the end. How did these 60 people not make him a hero? Can you answer that for me?
Let me guess, their comment section was, he's not a hero. He was just doing the job that he was signed up for. I do my job every day and I'm not a hero. You know that's true. You know it is.
Listen to this one here. This is about Jack Harold Lucas. He left school at the age of 14, and he joined the World War II effort with the Marine Corps Reserve. Eventually, while serving in Pearl Harbor, Lucas's true age was discovered, and he was kept in rear duties. But Lucas' desire to see combat and defend our country was so strong, he stowed away in an attack transport headed to Iwo Jima. After he was discovered and reprimanded, the 5th Marine Division allowed Lucas to join their party. On land in Japan, Lucas and his fellow troops found themselves trapped by enemies in a trench. Two grenades were thrown in. Lucas leapt on to the first to save the others, and then reached out and pulled the second one out from under his body and threw it. Only one grenade detonated, and Lucas was presumed dead after having saved the lives of several fellow soldiers. Amazingly, Lucas survived the blast and was evacuated for medical treatment. Upon recovering, he was awarded the Medal of Honor at age 17. The youngest Marine to ever receive the honor. 3,615 people said, he's a true hero. 38 people said, no, he's not a hero.
Oh! Ah! What is wrong with these people?
Tell me how you do that. What is in your head that a 17-year-old throws himself on a grenade to save his fellow soldiers, and this guy's not a hero? I just don't get people. What's a guy gotta do?
Bob, there are some people whose hearts are so shriveled and sour that nothing would please them.
Yeah.
And they all have really good Wi-Fi connections, apparently.
Evidently they do. Evidently they do. So today we salute these two heroes.
Who are heroes.
Of the past. Who are heroes. Who definitely are heroes. And one of the reasons that we're not speaking German or Japanese. This is Bob and Sheri.
Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
It is talk back time. There's so many ways to get in touch with the show, and we'd love to hear from you. You can email us at bobandsheri.com. You can DM us on any of the socials. If you have our app, which is free in Google Play and the Apple Store, and it's super, has all sorts of really great uses. You can listen to the show that way, you can listen to our podcasts, you can win prizes, and you can tap the microphone in the bottom right corner of the screen and talk.
Hi, Bob and Sheri. This is Allison in the Hudson Valley. I am calling because I was catching up on a podcast, and you were talking about a podcast where the podcaster was talking about how, because she is a British expat in America, her social circle runs into that of Ghislaine Maxwell. Well, my husband's a British expat living in America, and his social circle, as far as I know, and I did ask him, does not run into Ghislaine Maxwell. So, in defense of the British expat community living in America, not all of them are hanging out with Ghislaine Maxwell. Perhaps there is an economic thing going there. But, at any rate, thank you so much for all you do. Really appreciate it. Love listening to you guys.
What an upbeat person. It sounds like the weather is good in the Hudson Valley about this time of the year. What's the latest with Ghislaine Maxwell? Is she's still in prison,
she's
right?
She's still in prison waiting for her trial. But she did that notorious house. I guess it was some sort of a townhouse in London where the photograph of Prince Andrew with his beefy sausage fingers around the waist of the 17-year-old then Virginia Roberts.
Everybody's seen that. Yeah.
She just sold that. She got about, I think if I remember right, I saw it. I think it was $2.5 million, which she needs because her legal costs are insane. She put it on the market earlier this year and it didn't sell. It's a little bit notorious, but it finally did. So now she has an extra $2.5 million to pay lawyers. And she is reportedly, quote, sad about the sale of her refuge because there were so many happy memories for her there. But there's there's a chance that she might never have been able to go back and live there anyway. She's pleaded not guilty. I don't say that because she's going to do life in prison. I doubt she will. But because I suspect that she will be hounded for the rest of her life.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Why would you want to go back to a place where the neighbors all know exactly what you were up to? Your disgusting habit of grooming young girls for that pedophile. Why would you want to
go back there?
Allegedly. There'd be nothing but hate coming out of the eyes of all of your neighbors. It must tick off somebody who's got a lot of money, but they've been up to something where they have to take things like homes that they love in London and sell them, not to get another house, but to pay off lawyers, which are, I mean, you can end up with a situation like hers. You can end up being wiped out, even if you are rich, from law firms.
Yeah, yeah.
It's that expensive.
I'm telling you, whatever you think of what's going on with Ghislaine, you'll think differently about it if you listen to that podcast I was telling you guys about, Chasing Ghislaine. It's on Audible. It's a deep dive into who Ghislaine is and where Ghislaine comes from and who Jeffrey Epstein was. And it, what you think you know about Jeffrey Epstein is the tip of a very large, filthy iceberg. It's fascinating. I think, never mind what the neighbors think of her, I think that she will never be free of the press as long as she lives. Mm-mm. I think that every move she makes will be documented in some way. And I think she will be hounded by people who despise her, even if she's found innocent, who will despise her for the crimes she was charged with. What do you think?
So let's say that's you, right? And you don't do time. For some reason, you slipped away, but you got a fine or whatever. But you're a notorious scumbag, and that is what she is. You still have a lot of money. You still have, say, I don't know, $10 million. Where would you go?
I would go to the Bob and Sheri show because no one will find you there. How about you? Where are you going?
I'm going home. I'm going home. I still think I'm in show business, and maybe not. All right, if I had $10 million, I think that I would go to a small town out of this country, maybe somewhere like New Zealand. I mean, that's where what's-his-name from the Today Show was going, right? I don't know if he actually went there to his farm.
Lauer. Here's what I wonder, Bob. I wonder if New Zealand is too small for someone like that to safely hide out. New Zealand's a small, small country. And I'm not sure that those folks want a notorious person.
That's true. It's hard to get residency in Australia or New Zealand. Yeah.
Yeah.
They don't like those sort of people. But I think it would be a small town where maybe people are not as enamored with, you know, comings and goings of media. Well-known people, and so maybe they're not tracking the way she looks. Small town somewhere.
Well, it'll, you know what? We're going to find out sooner rather than later, although I'll be honest with you, I don't expect her to live a long life, happily or otherwise, at all. And I think that she doesn't either. This is a disaster of a situation, and I'm not sure anybody's going to let her just walk away. It's Bob and Sheri.
Leave us a talkback with the free Bob and Sheri app.
If you hear in the background, you might be able to just faintly hear a vacuum cleaner that is going. That is my wife going through her children's bedrooms. They have left to go to work and to college. And when they left, they left. I walked in. I was the only one in the house after they left. And I looked in, especially one of those bedrooms, and I was going to kind of pick it up and everything. And I went, I ain't going in there. I ain't touching nothing. Some of that stuff, I don't even know what it is. Why did they leave these clothes? Am I supposed to wash these clothes? What is going on? So she's in there going through it. And when she saw that the way the rooms were left, it's one of those situations where, as a husband, just shut up. Because anything at all that I could say would do nothing but put more fire on fire, gasoline on fire. You just have to let her go through it and embrace it and clean it by herself privately.
I'm dealing with this same thing. Kevin lost his mind at the condition one of those bedrooms was left in, and not unjustly. It wasn't just messy. It was filthy with like trash spilling on the floor. It was a disaster scene. Yep. He was taking pictures of it and texting it around and like a maniac. And so I was like, I saw it and I reached out to the owner of that bedroom and said, absolutely not, or you're losing your security deposit. What security deposit? The phone I pay for. Like, you're not, I am not doing this.
That's the ultimate threat that a parent has today, the phone. Because so Mary used it on one of them. Mary used it on one of them saying, oh, you're independent? By the way, I own that car and that phone. I can shut that down anytime I want. And the face goes white, you know?
Yeah.
Because that is their connection to the world.
Oh, listen, she's coming back because she doesn't want to lose her security deposit.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I have to be very careful when I look at things like this because I have become a bit of a neat freak. Tell me about if I should do this or not. We've got where I live, there are mailboxes and they're all the same. They're dark green and they're metal. Okay. And they're all the same on the street in which I live. So they all look pretty good. And I put in a new lawn in the front a couple of years ago, and I've been keeping it up and I've planted some nice trees and we have a fern on the front stoop and everything. It looks pretty nice. I mean, it's not like, you know, Bel Air, but it looks pretty nice. And most of the people around us, you know, keep it up pretty good. There's this one house and it's about three down across the street. And the people who own it are not there very much. They rent it out sometimes. The front yard is disgusting. They have left two giant branches, which just fell out of a big tree, just there. And it's the leaves are turned brown, and it looks disgusting. Weeds have grown up around the mailbox, and the mailbox has not been cleaned. I know it's weird to clean a mailbox. I know I'm weird that way. But this one, because of the humidity and everything, it's turned moldy. And it's disgusting looking. I am thinking of getting some 409 and surreptitiously, like on an early Sunday morning, going down and cleaning that mailbox and dragging those dead big, I mean, these limbs are like 12, 14 feet long, dragging them to a place where they do the pickup for litter. What do you think?
I think if that's what you want to do, you should do that. I do.
You don't think it's weird?
It doesn't matter if it's weird. I mean, I could say it's not weird. How generous that you want to help a neighbor who they may not be sloppy pigs. They may have something going on in their lives that makes cleaning a mailbox the lowest possible priority.
You could be doing somebody such a kindness.
You don't even know what's going on for those people. And to find out that, you know, somebody, some neighbor said, hey, I don't know what's going on with y'all, but let me pitch in and move these tree limbs. What a gesture of thoughtfulness. Even if it comes from a place of judgy neat freakery, it's still a nice gesture.
You could have left off the last line there and just said, what a nice gesture. Why'd you have to say that at the last line? I was feeling so good about myself.
Because that's then. You asked it. Would it be weird? You're just not looking at it the right way. That's all.
Well, I'm not, weird is one thing, but judgy and you know, really a harsh person, that's not
judgy neat freakery. But are you going to sit here and tell me that isn't judgy neat freakery, what you just said?
At this point, I just want to sell the house and move out of the neighborhood. I just don't want to be here anymore.
They don't want you to go. Who's going to clean up yard debris if the yard debris fairy moves?
Okay.
Straight ahead. Taking a vacation can save your life. You got to do it. It's Bob and Sheri.
You read it once.
I don't believe that.
And then you read it again.
I can't believe this.
It's Bob and Sherry's.
I don't believe this.
I cannot believe this.
Hey, do you feel like you're literally dying to take a vacation? Well, you might want to go ahead and take one, because not taking your vacation, especially if you're a man, could actually contribute to killing you. Let's talk about vacations. So let me get the bad news out of the way first. Turns out that men really benefit from getting away from their job. Now, if you are a man and you're at high risk for heart disease, so this is real specific, right? So look at your dad or your husband or whatever. People that took a vacation were less likely to die from heart disease than men who didn't.
Is that
so,
right?
Yeah, it's serious stuff. Like, it's a real deal. And they looked at these men. They looked at several thousand men, and they followed them for 14 years, and they studied them, and they found that it was consistent. If you don't take your vacation as a dude, it could kill you. Now, the reason that so many men don't take their vacation is because they're afraid they might not have a job to come back to. Because some jobs, even though it's your time off and you've earned it, you feel like you don't have enough job security to really take mm-hmm. that time off.
Well, I've known people, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which brings me to the next, because like I said, I want to get the bad news out of the way first, which brings me to the next piece of bad news. If you have an unstable job, you take your vacation, you are even more exhausted when you come back to work than when you left, because all of the stress of not knowing if you're going to have a job, if you're going to keep a job, if the job is going to make sense from one day to the next, that time away only make when you return to that crazy environment only makes you more exhausted. So there's one more tiny little piece before we can talk about all the fun stuff. For a vacation to change your health and to keep you alive, you have to find a vacation that lasts longer than just the days that you were gone. So you can't just like stay home and clean your house or garage, right? You have to mm-hmm. do something that is just purely pleasurable, whatever that is for you. And everybody's definition of pleasure is different. Some people mm-hmm. want to go really hardcore on a vacation. You know, they want to hike a million miles, or they want to surf or ride bikes or horses. Other people just want to sit in a chair and stare out at some water, whether it's a pool or a beach. There are people that really enjoy taking theme park vacations, and people who really enjoy a cabin in the woods with no Wi-Fi vacations. The vacation that's going to keep you alive is the vacation that speaks most directly to your heart. And when you take that vacation, it needs to last a week, a whole week, because it's that 1 week that makes you feel less tired, less stressed. You're in a better mood, you're more energized, and that's the time that helps heal your body, which is dying from all the stress that we all experience in this world. And
so just 4 days, like a long weekend or something, is not enough, according to this.
It's better than nothing, provided mm-hmm. that you're not spending those 4 days cleaning out the basement. Like, a vacation is not just time. What they're saying, Bob, is a vacation can't just be time off from work.
Right.
It has to be playful and pleasurable and fun. Doesn't have to be expensive, but it has to be relaxing. That's the word. So one of the things that is being looked at, especially by big companies that have kind of progressive ideas about how to treat the human beings that work there, is finding ways to help employees take those kinds of vacations so that they come back healthier and energized, ready to work. And for employers that just don't give a damn about your mood or your feelings, healthy employees don't cost you so much in health benefits and insurance. So
you know
there's
what,
that too.
You know what I don't think is a vacation, and yet it masquerades as a vacation? And I'm not denying that it has to happen. I'm not denigrating people who do it, because I did it year after year after year. And that is getting in a car and driving 5 hours to a mountain area, or usually a beach area, and maybe more than 5 hours, and hauling little kids down to the beach until they start complaining and they want to, now they're too hot, or they want to go in the pool, or they don't want to take a nap, or they don't want to stay with a babysitter so that mom and dad can go out to a movie or whatever. Those years are not vacations. That's hard work if you're doing it. You feel like you have to, because there's just something within us as Americans. We got to take the kids once a year someplace if we have the coins.
I miss all of that. I miss all of that so much. Those were my favorite vacations. Whether we were camping or at the beach, my favorite vacations was piles of kids and chaos. Wow. And that might be because
you
I've never
really... You should
have
called me up. I could have helped you out a little bit for a few years.
I might never have really had another kind of vacation, honestly.
Yeah.
I saved the last piece of good news just for you, and here it is. Just planning and daydreaming about a vacation, that anticipation of pleasure and relaxation, is good for your heart. So just daydreaming and planning your vacation
is I believe that. I'll post this up
on our Facebook so you can go check it out. It's Bob and Sheri.
People, pay attention, because I do not want to have to fail you.
Bob and Sheri want you to help us salute deserving teachers. Five winners will receive a box of school supplies, Bob and Sheri swag, a Bob and Sheri branded Visa gift card worth $100, and a one-year Stamps.com subscription valued at $200.
4.5 gold stars for you.
Get discounted USPS and UPS postage right from your computer at Stamps.com. Use promo code Sheri to start a four-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale.
May I have your attention? It's the Bob and Sheri Teacher Appreciation Contest.
Enter your deserving teacher at BobandSheri.com.
Swag you can use. Just hit shop at BobandSheri.com.
Okay, let's find out how much we know about what's going on in the world today. I have the UPI News Quiz. UPI stands for United Press International, and they cover news all over the world. And I didn't see the first Field of Dreams baseball game that was played this year with actual American baseball players. Was it American League or National League?
It was the White Sox against the Yankees, and it was they did something really cool. You know, in Field of Dreams, the players come out of the cornfield. Well,
yeah,
they brought the players in out of the cornfield. It was really cool.
Wow.
It was. I think the most watched regular season baseball game in many years. So
I bet
really cool.
It was. That's very cool. So our question is, in honor of that event, who did Kevin Costner portray in the movie Field of Dreams? Was it Ray Kinsella, Joe DiMaggio, or Babe Ruth?
Ray Kinsella.
That's right. I know nothing about him. Do you know anything about him, Max?
Ray Kinsella is just the name of the character in the movie. He was not an actual baseball player. The other two guys are.
He was just a farmer.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Second question. Delays for what equipment are jeopardizing NASA's plans to get back to the moon within a couple of years? Is it space toilets, space suits, or rocket launchers?
Space toilets?
It is spacesuits. They're having a tough time, evidently with some sort of an updated design. So that is what is the holdup right now. This one, I don't know anything about what the answer to this is or that this story is even going on. A civic group is fighting to be able to fly this flag on the Boston City Hall grounds. What flag is it? The Vatican flag? There's a lot of Catholics in Boston. The Republic of Ireland flag, a lot of Irish in Boston, or the Christian flag. Which one do you think it is?
And they want to fly it where in Boston? Tell me again.
It's City Hall.
City Hall?
Right. Christian flag, the Republic of Ireland flag, or the Vatican flag?
You know what? It could be any one of those. Mm-hmm. I don't even have, I would just be guessing.
Take a guess.
I'm going to say the Christian flag.
You're right. That's exactly right. I was guessing the Republic of Ireland flag, but it's the Christian flag. All right. What was the average price of gasoline in the United States at midweek, according to AAA? Was it $2.79, $3.19, or $4.39?
I'm saying $3.19.
$3.19.
$3.19 is it. Yeah, that's right. I bet it is $4.39 in certain places in the U.S., though. All right. I don't want to ask that one. That will get us a lot of really bad emails. The U.N. released a report that its chief called a code red emergency for humanity. What did the report address? The COVID-19 pandemic, sex trafficking, or climate change?
I'm going to have a write-in answer, and I'm going to go with Free Britney. Free Britney for the win. Free Britney.
No, it's not. It's climate change. climate change.
But we still need to free Britney. Worried. I just want to get that. Enter this into the record, please, that we still need to free Britney.
Listen, before Madison left, she came in. I was having a glass of wine, and she says, "Can I give you an update on Britney and what's going on?" I went, "Yeah, sure. What's going on?" She has been following this for like 4 or 5 years. And she's one of those people that just wants that girl left alone. And to listen to the detail of what she knew about the case with the father and all of that was really interesting.
Well, I'm glad to see that she's passionate about human rights, because that's important. It's Bob right, and Sheri. Exactly.
Now, let's open up the Bob and Sheri Archive Vault.
Yesterday morning, I woke up and I just looked around my house and I thought, this place is a pigsty. And I'm stomping around trying to clean stuff up, but I have the PMS and it's crawling all over me. Now you get out there and you buy me a house! Because this one's a pigsty! He's like, well, we have to clean it up, you know, anyway. I just want to burn it to the ground. And you know why I want to burn it to the ground? Because my cousin Renee, who I love, who loves my kids, keep sending me the biggest, giantest, plasticest stuff for them to play with. Do you know what she sent the other day? It is a ginormous, I'm talking 5 feet tall and a 5 foot around inflatable ball that you plug your sprinkler in and water shoots out of it.
Mm-hmm. It sounds like fun.
You know how much space that takes up?
It's 5 feet round?
It's 5 feet around and 5 feet tall. I picture a giant inflatable beach ball that is also a sprinkler.
Okay. So it comes out of all
of... Water shoots out
really
of the jets.
That's really cool. I like to see that.
Yeah, here's how my kids play with it. One picks it up in her hand and bludgeons the other with it, right? It's sharing space in the backyard with the giant 4 foot tall, 4 foot wide... plastic rubbery canvas that you can paint with and then wash off with the hose. Mm-hmm. And on and on and on. But the house is covered with this stuff. And so I had the PMS, which I can report to you all has subsided today. So that's good news for you, mm-hmm. right? And you know how when you have the PMS, you just, everything you see displeases you and must be eliminated.
I don't know how that is, but I've been on the receiving end of it. Yeah.
Receiving end, yeah. And nothing anybody can say to you, nothing that can happen will make you feel better, because what you are is a raving, psychotic, loony biatch. Mm-hmm. And you're just completely not responsible for your own behavior. You're as out of control as Mel Gibson after a margarita party. I mean, you're just done. So I took my rage at how nasty the house was looking and scrubbed the outside. Like, I cleaned up the backyard. And by that point, I was out of energy for it.
You know, the thing about being a guy is you can live with a woman for 20 years and you still will always forget that this could come around from time to time. Could be every month, could be every 6 months, whatever. You forget that it actually exists. You never identify it and you take it personally almost every time. You know, she just walks into the room and says, you know, the way you are... with my friends, I sometimes wonder, Bob. And you're going,
Where's that coming from?
What are you talking about, your friends? Which friend? Oh, you know which friend. No, I really don't know which. You know which one, Bob. And it goes on for like 2 days, and then all of a sudden you go, oh. Or you know what really drives the guys nuts? After 2, 3, 4 days of this, you finally say, you know what? You're just a big B. That's all you are. You're big B. And here's why. And you've done this and you've done that. And you've made me feel this terrible. And I never did any of that stuff. And blah, blah, blah. And then she says, well, I'm sorry. I had my period.
Do you know, I've learned from your suffering over the years to get in front of that by saying, because I really don't suffer from that very frequently. But when I have it, it's bad.
If you all could just put like a special hat on.
I have
it. If you walk around, you do.
It's pointy and black with a really wide brim.
Yeah, but you wear that all the time.
We've got my cousin Renee on the line. Hey, Renee.
Hey, Sheri. Hi, Bob.
Hi, Renee.
Renee, we were just talking about you.
You know, funny thing is, the kids and I were on the computer, and I said, hey, let's listen to Aunt Sheri.
And you heard.
No.
Renee, I have to tell you, I had the PMS walking all over me and the giant inflatable beach ball sprinkler that Olivia was beating her post-op sister with, I almost had a psychotic break.
Which I had no idea about.
Well, I called to tell you, but you were at work.
Okay.
And so I tell them, oh, they beg to go in the, oh, Aunt Renee Beach Ball, Aunt Renee Beach Ball. So I get it all set up for them. And they're going around. They're going around. I hear the phone ring inside. I run in to grab the phone. I walk outside holding the phone. And Olivia has the giant beach ball sprinkler and is beating Karamia in the head with it.
Oh, my. Yeah, so we just happened to tune in. And I did read your thing where you told everybody that I had trench mouth. And then I tune in and I'm like, great. Everybody knows that I had trench mouth as a kid.
And now
And
now you're giving gifts that she doesn't even appreciate. In fact, she hates.
Like the big giant canvas.
Oh my God.
There's just nothing.
So they're not painting inside all over the house.
There's just nothing Renee can buy that makes her happy.
Our backyard is Six Flags over Aunt Renee. It is all the giant Aunt Renee attractions. And that is why you are the beloved favorite. But Renee, you are calling at a very good moment because we're talking about whether or not when you've got the bad psychotic PMS, should give an advance warning so that in your case, for example, your husband Frank would know to avoid you like the plague.
Like wear a hat.
He just looks at me and he sees the horns growing. And he knows.
You can hear more from the Bob and Sheri archives at bobandsheri.com.
The Bob and Sheri website, the Oddcast, contest info, bobandsheri.com.
Okay, it's time now for Bob and Sheri's Small Plates. These are interesting little stories from around our great country and the world. I was just reading about the old Black Plague. You know, you hear about the Black Plague these days.
Little light reading, yes.
Right? People always say, well, at least it's not the Black Plague. Black Plague was pretty bad. It was in the 1300s in Europe. And now listen to this. Listen to how things change and yet they don't. After the Black Plague, depopulation in Europe caused a shortage of laborers. So many people died. Hundreds of thousands of people died. And that's when the population of the world was a lot less back then. So to lose that many people was a big deal. So many people died. There was a shortage of workers, and the workers were then able to, guess what? Demand higher wages for work. Some estimates state that the typical workers' wages increased by 50%. And what are you hearing right now? Oh, you'll get a signing bonus if you come to work at McDonald's. Oh, we need help in any area. We'll train you for 3 months and you don't have to worry about it. It's the same thing now. People are demanding more, just like they did 600 years ago.
Isn't that incredible? Like the parallels? Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. My second small plate here is I was just thinking about this. I was in the supermarket the other day and I saw a Time magazine. It's not a magazine, but it's kind of cross between a book and a magazine. And it's about the Beatles. It's about the Beatles. And then there was another one about John Wayne. Now, John Wayne's been dead for years. There are people listening right now, young people, who kind of know who he is, but not 100%. His movies are still on, but he started making movies in the 1930s. That's a long time ago. And yet, when I'm checking out, there is a book, a magazine/book, about John Wayne. That's how powerful and popular he still is. I think the big three that'll never go away are Hitler, the Beatles, and John Wayne. So
I want to add to that. Can I add Elvis and Princess Diana to that?
You know, I think you're right. I think you're right. You are right. That's exactly right. So it's the five entities. So I'm looking, I can't check out, and I'm looking through this book, and he never served as a soldier. He just didn't. Maybe he was a little too old or whatever. He didn't, but he played soldiers, and everybody kind of thinks of him as a brave soldier. But I'm looking through this, and I learned a couple of things about John Wayne. Thing number one, the only time he got hate mail, this is how much he was liked. Today, there are people that have trouble with him. But when he was alive, the only hate mail he ever got was because as a conservative, and he was a very conservative Republican, he sided with Carter to give Panama the Panama Canal back. He said they should get it. It's in their country. I know we built it, but it's right through their country. They should control the Panama Canal. And the hate mail came in for the first time in John Wayne's career. And the other thing that jumped out at me, my father, I think, smoked 2 packs of cigarettes a day. Kent cigarettes. How much did you think John Wayne smoked per day?
Take a guess.
Is it more than that? Oh,
yes.
Okay. I'm going to say that the Duke put down 5 packs a day.
7 packs of cigarettes per day.
How do you do that?
I don't know.
When do you sleep? And John Wayne, because he doesn't even need to. He can just keep it in his mouth while he pees. So he just basically, from the moment his eyes opened, had a lit cigarette in his mouth until he went to bed that night.
Now, he got cancer twice, and he did television ads. I beat the Big C. And then the Big C came back, unfortunately, and beat him. That is an amazing amount of tobacco. And I was watching, I had one of his movies on once, and it was in black and white. And I think he was playing the commander of the Flying Tigers in the Pacific Theater. And somebody offers him a cigar. One of the characters offers, his character a cigar. And John Wayne says, "I think I'll pass. I'm a cigarette man myself." And I often wondered, was the movie paid for him to say that? Did the tobacco industry, even back then, try to pull something, a stunt like that, get the most popular actor in America, the most macho guy in America, and get him to say he's a cigarette man so that subconsciously all men watching want to smoke a cigarette to be like the Duke?
It's an interesting and sinister thought, and I kind of would say maybe, because you know that Hollywood made smoking so glamorous back in the day.
It did. Yes, it did. But those are chosen words. Why would they have that scene in there? You want a cigar? I'm a cigarette man myself. Why would that? That's like an unnecessary line. It didn't advance the story at all. I think they got paid, and I think he got paid for it.
Wow. 7 packs a day, though. How many cigarettes are in a pack again? Can you tell me how many?
20. Aren't there 20?
Yeah,
max?
I think it's 20.
Yeah.
I don't know how you...
140.
140.
I'm not 100% sure how you would do that.
I know.
I'm not sure how long... You guys used to be smokers. How long does it take a person to smoke a cigarette on average?
It depends on how nervous you are.
Well, it's
what
John
would you
Wayne,
say, though? That's
so
a good
chill.
Question. 3 minutes?
3 to 5?
Yeah, somewhere in there.
Yeah, somewhere
good
around
grief.
There. Good
yeah. grief. It's an impressive, deadly accomplishment. I mean, it just shows you the commitment. Wow.
Yeah.
Well,
that's a
okay.
lot.
Okay.
It's Bob and Sheri.
Instant access to the podcast, and fun side. Just download the free Bob and Sheri app.
Have you ever had a golden retriever, Bob?
It
feels like
not,
something you would have. Doesn't it feel like a dog you would
wonderful.
Have had somewhere in the past?
Yeah,
I've never had
wonderful.
A golden retriever. My best friend, who's no longer with us, had a gorgeous golden retriever named Biscuit, who was just as sweet as this was the world's sweetest dog. Like, you could strap a baby to this dog's back and tell the dog, go into town and get medicine, and the dog would have done it, right? A dog would do anything. And she fed this dog. Biscuit got dog food, but Biscuit also got whatever human leftovers were around. I've seen this dog eat cranberry sauce, like whatever was on a person's plate, this dog would eat, right? So, and they're so good with kids. They're just the sweetest dogs. Did you know how the golden retriever gets that beautiful golden blonde butterscotch coat? Because it's a wild little fun fact. So that golden retriever coat. And anytime you see a dog with that honey blonde golden hair, that is the result of genetics from an extinct dog that split off from gray wolves 2 million years ago.
Wow.
So
2 million years ago.
2 million
wow.
years ago. Yeah. So for the longest time, we just assumed that all these thousands of years of dogs living with people and selective breeding of dogs was the reason why dogs have so many different coats. Like, how do you look at a Dalmatian, a pug, a Rottweiler, and an Irish setter? They all come from, they're all descended from the same wolf, right? Mm-hmm. Well, the golden retrievers, more than 2 million years ago, there was a primitive dog that did not survive to the current day. And that dog, there was a mutation in the gene that regulates coat color. And that one went kind of wild. And as a result, 5 different coat patterns came out of that. That's dominant yellow, like in a golden retriever, and then shaded yellow, coats that alternate kind of dark and light, a little bit stripey almost, mm-hmm. black, and black saddle. And you've seen these on dogs a million times. All of that comes from this wolf that dogs were part of, a descendant of, more than 2 million years ago, which is long, long before dogs became domesticated. Because dogs really have only been domesticated for about 30,000 years. I think we talked about this on the show just recently. So that genetic combination that gives you your golden retriever, they share those genes with Arctic white wolves, who also get their white coat from these gray wolves 2 million plus years ago.
That's amazing. Yeah.
So your sweet golden retriever that would carry a baby around in its mouth shares that with white wolves in the Arctic. That blows my mind.
That's something. You know what I read the other day, and I am more of a dog person, although I care for Kiki, the cat in the house. I'm giving her medicine. I'm the one that, you know, gets to feed her most of the time, the litter box, the whole thing. But I've been sweet to Kiki, and she can jump up on my lap and I will pet her. She allows me to do that. But I'm not cat person. I was reading something the other day that somebody who loves cats said, and it made sense. This person said, cats get a bad rap because people expect cats to be like dogs, and they're not. Their nature is totally different. So when you relate to a cat, you have to realize that's not Rover. You know, that's not Biscuit. That is a cat. And they have a different way of looking at life. They're smaller. They come from a different background. You've got to deal with their finickiness if you really want to embrace them. They're not man's best friend, and they don't want to be.
You know, it's interesting that you say that, because it's like, as soon as you say it, you go, well, yeah, of course, obviously. But as I'm sitting here thinking about it, I know so many people that are disappointed that their cat doesn't do what a dog would do.
Yeah.
But if you really like sit back and let your cat do a cat thing, they're kind of awesome. It's like living with tiny little predators. They're kind of amazing to watch.
Even
Kiki, because I've been at your house when Kiki's been sitting out on the back deck and you watch her watching the natural world, and you see her like calculating. She doesn't chase birds or hunt, but you see that she has this instinct to do it. She watches it, she moves.
There's curiosity there. I saw this wonderful picture online. It was a golden retriever. I mean, a full grown golden retriever, and it had stuffed itself into a box, a cardboard box, which came up to its chest. And all you can see is the chest and the head of the golden retriever looking out. And the person said, my golden was raised with 6 cats. This is what he's learned.
I saw
it was priceless.
There was a great Instagram post last weekend for Catter Day where this guy took a picture of his cat sleeping on the kitchen counter and his dog sleeping on the kitchen table. And the caption was like, he lives with cats. He thinks he's a cat. It was so funny.
Yeah, so, this golden too.
So now you know how your golden got golden. It's Bob and Sheri.
People, pay attention, because I do not want to have to fail you.
Bob and Sheri want you to help us salute deserving teachers. 5 winners will receive a box of school supplies, Bob and Sheri swag, a Bob and Sheri branded Visa gift card worth $100, and a 1-year Stamps.com subscription valued at $200.
4.5 gold stars for you.
Get discounted USPS and UPS postage right from your computer at Stamps.com. Use promo code Sheri to start a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale.
May I have your attention? It's the Bob and Sheri Teacher Appreciation Contest.
Enter your deserving teacher at bobandsheri.com.
K
Congratulations, Sheri Lynch, named one of the most influential women in radio again this year. It's Bob and Sheri.
I guess this story took a little bit to trickle out to the public, but I'm kind of fascinated by it. This was just a couple of weeks ago on July 30th. A Canadian military jet flying between a military base in Ontario and one in Cologne, Germany, along with a KLM Airlines flight that was traveling from Boston to Amsterdam. Both pilots in both aircraft reported seeing a bright green flying object that flew into a cloud and disappeared over eastern Canada last month. And there were no negative impacts to either of the flights, okay? But when they looked at the flight data information, the Canadian military plane made a change in course and climbed 1,000 feet when they reported seeing the UFO. So what's unclear is, did the Royal Canadian Air Force pilot change course to avoid the UFO or to see what it was or to avoid a collision, or if that altitude change was completely routine and just a coincidence? Meanwhile, at the same time, this commercial flight, the KLM flight, in the same airspace, reported seeing their description. It was the same bright green object disappeared into the clouds. Of course, we don't know what they saw, and I'm sure it was swamp gas or a weather balloon or a sunspot. You know, I'm sure it was nothing that these experienced commercial and military pilots saw. What is most interesting about this for me is that these stories now, these pilots are openly reporting these kind of sightings and encounters and not keeping it quiet for fear of being ridiculed.
Wow. That's what's changed.
That's what's changed, yeah.
Yeah.
So the Canadian military has archives loaded with UFO reports that go back like almost 70 years. And of course, I'll remind you, we talked about this on the show, that back in, I want to say it was 2015, the former defense minister for Canada said the governments are hiding aliens, many of whom walk amongst us. Do you remember that? It sounded so kooky when we talked about it, but he was the former defense minister of Canada.
And I think we all can agree that Canadians are never up to foolishness.
Canadians are not foolish people.
No.
They're just not. And all of the foolish Canadians are exported to the USA to work on Saturday Night Live and in Ghostbusters.
That's true. Yeah, that's very, very true, actually.
So it's just, you know what? It's just kind of interesting that this is a pretty big change in the way this news is being reported.
Right.
And in the way pilots, military and commercial, are handling these sightings.
Right. Now, that's right.
So I just thought I would share that, because I'm going to go ahead and guess that, Max, even you, and you follow this, you didn't know about this, right?
No, didn't hear that story.
In part because there's so much else happening in the world that it chokes up your news feed with endless catastrophes. But this is a pretty big one, y'all. This is a pretty big one. It's Bob and Sheri.
Hey, thank you so much for listening to the Bob and Sheri podcast and the Bob and Sheri Oddcast. We would love if you would subscribe, rate and review, and share it with a friend on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, wherever you go. And thank you again for listening.